First step in the carving is to draw the midlines, measure the crown length, measure the root length, draw midlines on all the aspects, palatal aspect, the distal aspect. Carving should begin with the buccal aspect. You have to measure the maxillodistal width at the cervix and the maximum maxillodistal width at the maximum surface, that is at the contact areas. The mesial crest of curvature is in the junction of middle and occlusal third, whereas the distal contact area is at the middle of the middle third. So for the first step, we divide the buccal segment into three. We have the apical, middle and the occlusal third. The mesial contact area is at the junction of the middle and the occlusal third. Distal contact area is in the middle of the middle third. After you have measured the correct maxillodistal dimension at the cervix and at the maximum, you draw lines joining the contact areas and the cervical width like this. So that you get a shape roughly in the shape of a trapezoid, with the cervix being narrow and the occlusal surface being the broadest. Next step would be to cut it through and through. Make sure you remove the cervical portion. So this finishes the mesial contact area at the junction of middle and occlusal third. Similarly, cut on the distal aspect also. Flatten it. Then at the cervix, remove the wax. So you have the distal contact area at the middle of the middle third, mesial contact area at the junction of the middle and the occlusal third. So the same shape is reflected both in the buccal as well as your palatal aspects. The angle formed by the crown and the base of the block should be acute. So it should be properly cut in this cervical. It should not be dirty like this. It should be removed. After we finish the buccal aspect, we have to move on to the mesial or the distal aspect. We draw the midlines. This is the mesial aspect. Here is the buccal aspect. And this becomes your lingual aspect or palatal aspect. The buccal crest of curvature is in the cervical third, whereas the lingual crest of curvature is in the middle of the middle third. So again, you divide the surface into three. The middle of the middle third will be the lingual crest of curvature, and in the cervical third will be your buccal crest of curvature. Measure the the labial lingual width at the cervix and at the maximum, and then draw lines in such a way that you have the buccal crest of curvature at the cervical third, the lingual crest of curvature at the middle of the middle third. And like you did in the labial aspect, cut the wax through and through. Flatten the surface. In the cervix also remove the wax. So you have a single line which marks the crest of curvature on the palatal aspect here. Clear it. Same thing has to be done on the buccal aspect also. cervix also, remove a layer of wax. So you can observe a single line here that will be at the cervical third. So now observing the tooth from the distal aspect, you can see the crest of curvature buccally is in the cervical third, lingually is in the middle of the middle third. The same way if you observe it from the mesial aspect, lingual portion is middle and buccal portion is in the cervical third. When you change over the tooth to the occlusal aspect, you can see the crest of curvature buccally and lingually is marked by the outermost border. The mesial and the distal contact area is marked by the outermost portion on the mesial and distal side. Occlusal, you have a rough square which is going to be your occlusal table, where the four cusps will be in the four corners. After we finish the buccal aspect and the mesial aspect, we will start carving the outline from the occlusal aspect. Occlusally, there are four line angles, two buccal and two lingual line angles. The distobuccal line angle, which is on this side, this is the distal side, buccal side, distobuccal line angle should be obtuse. Similarly, the mesiopalatal line angle should be obtuse. So we will be rounding off these two diagonally opposite line angles, the mesiobuccal and your distopalatal will be acute. So just remove wax on both sides so that you get a roughly rhomboid shape from the occlusal aspect. So the distobuccal line angle has become more obtuse. The mesiopalatal line angle will be obtuse but less obtuse compared to that of your distobuccal line angle. Other two line angles just round off so that it remains acute. So now this is the rough occlusal outline in which the buccal segment and the lingual segment can be clearly differentiated. Next step would be to divide the occlusal table that is represented by this square, divide it mesiodistally into a buccal segment and a lingual segment, followed by leave 1 mm gap from the buccal and the lingual outlines on the occlusal table and draw two lines like this. So you have 1 mm gap on the buccal segment, 1 mm gap on the lingual segment. The depth of your marginal ridge varies from 1 mm to 0.5 mm. So from the occlusal surface, at a depth of 0.5 to 1 mm, we mark a point and then we draw lines in such a way that you have a V-shaped cut which can be given from the occlusal aspect. Give a V-shaped notch from the occlusal aspect. Same way from the buccal segment. So once you have shaped the occlusal aspect, you have the buccal segment here, the buccal segment, the lingual segment. You can see 1 mm wide flat area. So you can see a rectangular portion here and here, which is going to be your cusps lingually and buccally. The central groove will be along the center line. The same tooth, when we visualize from the mesial or the distal aspect, you can see the V-shaped groove that is formed. So you can see the V-shaped groove, and this groove is going to be the final place of your marginal ridges mesially and distally. Right. The next step would be to divide the buccal and the lingual aspects so that you have the two buccal cusps and the lingual cusp. Okay. Now you have the buccal aspect here. In the buccal aspect, the central groove is actually divided between the mesio buccal and the disto palatal line angle. Because of the disto buccal line angle being more obtuse, you can still see a portion of your disto palatal line angle from the buccal aspect. So actually you have to divide the width between the disto palatal and the mesio buccal. So you draw a line dividing the two line angles. So this is going to be your buccal groove. Similarly, the lingual groove will be exact midline, but since the mesiopalatal cusp is a little larger, you will mark a line 1 millimeter more distal to the buccal groove, like this. So this lingual groove is 1 millimeter distal to the buccal groove. After you do this, mark 1 millimeter away from the rectangle beginning where we have already marked. So you have a small square here. Similarly, on the lingual aspect, you have one more small square here, and this will be the smallest cusp. After you do this, cut again a V-shaped notch again from both the buccal cusps. So this will become your distal slope of your mesiobuccal cusp, and this will become your mesial slope of your distobuccal cusp. Similarly, on the palatal aspect, mark a V-shaped notch. So this is going to be your distal slope of the largest cusp, that is the mesiopalatal, and this is going to be your mesial slope of the distopalatal cusp, which is going to be your smallest. So if you visualize from the occlusal aspect, you have the four tentative cusps. From the buccal aspect, you can see a V-shaped notch which we have carved from the occlusal aspect. So this is going to be the two buccal cusps. You turn it around to the palatal aspects. Again, you have a V-shaped notch. You have the largest cusp, that is the mesiopalatal, followed by your distopalatal cusps. The next step would be to carve the triangular ridges. The triangular ridges proceed from the two buccal cusps down towards the central groove. When it comes to the mesio buccal cusp, the triangular ridge goes down straight and meets the mesial triangular ridge of your mesiopalatal cusp, whereas the distal triangular ridge goes in an oblique direction to meet the triangular ridge of your disto buccal cusp to form the oblique ridge. So this means that the largest cusp, that is the mesiopalatal cusp, has two triangular ridges, one extending down straight to meet the opposing buccal cusp to form the transverse ridge, whereas it goes diagonally across to meet the diagonally opposite buccal cusp to form the oblique ridge. Now to start carving, we will first draw two lines just inside the outer border of the mesial and the distal aspects. So this is the outline mesially. So we have drawn a line just inside 1 millimeter. Similarly, on the buccal aspect, on the distal aspect also, we will be drawing a line like this. So you have one line on the distal side, one line on the mesial side. Once you do that, the carver's position is very important for carving the triangular ridges. So we have a thin straight portion of the carver which we can see in this place. So this straight portion of carver, and the tip is in one location. Now the tip of the carver has to be positioned in such a way that it is always in line with the two lines which you have drawn inside, but the slope of the carver should be parallel to the slope of the two cusps. For example, this is the cusp slope which is seen from the buccal aspect. This is the mesiobuccal cusp, the mesial slope of the mesiobuccal cusp. So you keep the carver in such a way that the small portion of your carver is in line and is parallel to the mesial slope of the mesiobuccal cusp. But the tip of your carver should be at the location of your line which you have drawn. So starting from the occlusal aspect, like in this direction, you proceed in such a way that you go down along the line which you have drawn. So the tip of the carver will go along the line in this direction. Slightly remove a layer of wax, but go parallel to the outer line which you have drawn. So you can see a slope which is formed in this direction, and this is going to be one of the slopes, the mesial slope of your triangular ridge from the mesiobuccal cusp. Similarly, from the palatal cusp, the mesiopalatal cusp, start from the cusp tip. The tip of the carver should be in line like this. Starting there, you go down straight in this direction so that it meets the opposing triangular ridge slope which you have carved. So you can see one surface in this direction and another one in this direction. This is going to be your future marginal ridge. So this will complete one surface of your triangular ridge which is going to be carved. Now going on to the other aspect of the same mesiobuccal cusp. So starting from the cusp tip so that your smaller slope of the carver is parallel to the buccal cusp slope. Start from there and go down straight till the midline in this direction. So once you do that, your tip of the carver should go along the buccal groove line. So once you finish it, this finishes the triangular ridge of your mesiobuccal cusp. This finishes with the triangular ridge of the mesiobuccal cusp, and you can see the two slopes of the triangular ridges, even of the mesiopalatal cusp. You can see the formation of the marginal ridge. The triangular portion of extra wax should be scraped off. It will complete your mesial marginal ridge, the level of which can be adjusted later on. Make sure that we correctly measure the mesiodistal dimension, otherwise when we remove more wax to correct the dimension, the marginal ridge will be damaged. Now we have to carve two triangular ridges from the mesiopalatal cusp, one going the direction of the mesiobuccal cusp which is going to form the transverse ridge, one going in the direction of the distobuccal cusp forming the oblique ridge. So we have a small triangular portion of wax here in this region. So we have two slopes, one going in an oblique direction, one going in a straight direction. We roughly bisect the triangular portion. So you draw a line bisecting the two slopes of the triangle. Then we start from this depth of the central sulcus, the tip of the carver going along the line in this till the mesiopalatal cusp. So you remove a layer of wax in such a way that you divide the triangular portion of wax into two. Similarly, starting from the central area again, but the carver placed in an opposite direction, you remove another layer of wax. So once we clear this, so you can make out a rough triangular ridge being formed on two directions. So this will be your transverse ridge, the other one would be your oblique ridge. Appreciate a transverse ridge extending from the mesiopalatal to the mesiobuccal cusp in this direction, and you have the mesial slope of the oblique ridge which can be formed here. So just to finish the oblique ridge, you will be shaping the distal slope of the oblique ridge in this way. So you have a triangular ridge with one slope on the mesial side, another on the distal side. Similarly, the distobuccal cusp will have a triangular ridge going down the cusp ridges along the distal triangular ridge of the mesiopalatal cusp. So again, starting from the cusp tip, going down the same direction. you have the oblique ridge forming in this way. So the other slope of the same cusp can be carved. This finishes with the oblique ridge. See the oblique ridge running from the mesiopalatal cusp to the distobuccal cusp in an oblique direction. Now the last triangular ridge which has to be carved is your distopalatal cusp, which is very small, and the triangular ridge will be parallel to the outer border of the distal outline. So same way as that of what we carved in the mesiobuccal cusp, we will be holding the cover with the tip pointing at the line which you have drawn, going down straight till the center in this direction. Similarly, rotate it. Then along the palatal line, palatal groove, you carve another slope. So you have a nice triangular ridge running down like this with two slopes on either side. Similarly, as we did for the mesial marginal ridge, polish the distal marginal ridge. So you have a small triangular fossa automatically developing here. Clear of all the debris. So this roughly finishes your triangular ridges, oblique ridge, transverse ridge, and a small single triangular ridge. This finishes the occlusal carving. You can see the two marginal ridges on either side. You can see the triangular ridges, two triangular ridges extending from the mesiopalatal cusp, one going straight towards the component of the buccal mesiobuccal cusp, forming the transverse ridge, obliquely to form the oblique ridge with the distobuccal cusp triangular ridge, a small triangular ridge which is parallel to the outer border of the distopalatal. You can see the marginal ridge very clearly. You can see the central fossa forming here and a small distal fossa which is comma shaped, and these grooves in the center will extend on the buccal and lingual aspect respectively to form your buccal and the lingual grooves. So we will extend the buccal groove first, extending onto the buccal surface. It will extend halfway on the buccal surface. So this will divide the mesiobuccal and the distobuccal cusp. So you have to make the mesiobuccal cusp more obtuse, reshaping it in an obtuse angle. The mesial and the distal slopes of the distobuccal cusp forms a 90 degree. So you have the buccal groove. Similarly, you will be carving your palatal groove, which runs along the distal groove extended down onto the lingual aspect. The lingual groove starts from the center of the lingual surface and extends onto the occlusal surface. From this point onwards, you can sharpen the cusp in such a way so you have a sharp mesiopalatal cusp. The distopalatal cusp will be roughly rounded. You have to make a 90 degree cusp for the distopalatal cusp. Roughly 90 degrees here. The distobuccal cusp will be rounded this way. Okay. So this finishes with your crown, which appears tentatively. You can see the obtuse angles, you have the acute angles. The fifth cusp, or the cusp of Chiaravilli, is situated on the lingual aspect of the mesiopalatal cusp. It is roughly 2 millimeters below the cusp slopes of the mesiopalatal cusp, running parallel in this direction. So you draw a line so that it outlines the same as that of your mesiopalatal cusp, starting from the lingual groove and extending till the mesiolingual line angle. So we have the outline of the cusp of Chiaravilli. Remove one layer of wax towards the occlusal surface in this direction. So you have the elevation of the cusp of caraveli, as you can see from the glossal aspect as well as from the lingual aspect. So this will finish your crown from this aspect. That finishes the crown. To carve the root along the cervical width of the crown, draw two parallel lines on the root portion. And from here you will start removing the wax full length, starting from the buccal aspect till the lingual aspect. So in one shot you cut wax in such a way. It evenly removes from the buccal as well as your palatal aspects. Okay, so this finishes the way how we start the root formation. So you can also remove wax, keeping the tooth in the occlusal aspect and then removing wax. But make sure you don't extend the root length, exactly till the root length. Now this procedure should be used only for the buccal aspect. The palatal root is more lingually placed compared to that of your crown. So you remove wax for the root portion. You can remove more from the buccal aspect, but the lingual aspect, the lingual border of the root should be flush with the wax block itself. That is why we will be removing wax only on the two sides in this manner. Remove wax. According to Cope Osborne's theory, we have a primary cusp trigone, and the primary cusp involves the two buccal cusps and the mesiopalatal cusp. The fifth cusp as well as your distopalatal cusp are considered to be secondary cusp. So overall shape of the root resembles this primary cusp trigone, and it has a triangular outline. So when we cut the tooth at this location, you have a triangular outline. That is why you should give more amount of lingual convergence in the root portion of the tooth. So you remove more wax so that lingually the mesiodistal width is narrower than the buccal mesiodistal width. So once you do this, give a slight concavity in the cervical portion so that the root appears to go out of the crown portion. So you use the concavity of the carver and give concavity in the cervical portion of the tooth. Don't go till the root length, because this portion of the root should be outside the crown. Merge it, polish the area. Palatal root. So you can appreciate from this aspect, you can see there is a concavity on the lingual portion, and the lingual portion, that is the palatal root, is slightly more outwardly placed, whereas the buccal root is evenly placed. So the division of the root will be first in the mesiodistal direction. So on either on the mesial or the distal side, you will be marking a point roughly 5 mm from the distal aspect, whereas 3 mm from the mesial aspect. After you mark this, you have to start removing wax in such a way that it goes through and through, and it divides the two buccal roots and the palatal root. Already you can see the carver emerging from the opposite side. initiate the bifurcation. Then the other side. So you have a palatal root, you can see the bifurcation complete. So you have the buccal segment of the root and the palatal segment of the root. Once this is finished, we have to divide the buccal root into two. So the buccal root bifurcation begins 4 millimeters from the cervical width, so mark a point 4 millimeter. Then from that, draw a V-shaped groove and then divide this tooth till the bifurcation in the mesiodistal direction which you have already given. So starting from here till the depth of the buccal root segment, you will be removing wax. So deepen the groove slowly. Bifurcation luckily is complete. Now we have to shape the tooth in a proper fashion. Now when we carve the root of the tooth, we will see that the buccal segment, the distal distobuccal root and the mesiobuccal root. The distobuccal root will roughly form an acute angle with the cervical line, whereas the mesiobuccal root will be perpendicular. So you have to shape it in such a way that it remains 90 degrees. So shape the cervical portion. So this is going to be your future cervical line. So this is perpendicular. Give a little concave to the distal portion. Have it. Give a concavity like this. Concavity will give the acute angle. So you shape it so that the roots are distally inclined. Similarly on the mesial root also, remove more from the apical portion so that the mesial root also is distally inclined. So once this is done, you have the three roots which can be clearly made out. Now comes the finishing. Give concavity on the cervical portion on all the aspects, round off the line angles. So you just have to pass your curved portion of the carver in all the direction like this. Now from the occlusal aspect, start removing wax so that the lingual convergence of the palatal root becomes more prominent. So start removing wax this direction like this. Slightly widen the bifurcation on the lingual side. Once you widen it, just remove more of the lingual surface. So you have to remove the buccal portion of the lingual root so that it becomes roughly banana shaped, as they call it. Same way from the mesial and the distal aspect. Palatal root, we have increased the size of the fossa. Now the buccal roots, the apical portion, make it more rounded by passing the carver on either root. So once you round it off, there is a developmental depression starting from the cervical line till the bifurcation. So which extends from the middle of the cervical line till the bifurcation in this direction. This will be one developmental depression. Secondly, starting from the lingual outline of the mesiobuccal root, going in a lingual direction this way, you have a developmental depression. So use the other side of the carver to give the developmental depressions. Similarly, on the distal distobuccal root from the lingual outline, extend it more lingually, so you have a root in this direction, developmental depression. Buccally on the crown at the end of the buccal groove, mesiodistally there is a developmental depression because of which you get a slight concavity in the middle portion of the buccal outline when you see it from the distal or mesial aspect. After you finish this, recording, you polish all the surfaces. So once you polish, all the outlines can be very clearly seen. Polish such a way that line angles are rounded. Polish even the contact areas. All the small irregularities on the wax should go away like this. Now the tooth is ready without the cervical line. So to draw the cervical line, the buccally, the cervical line dips in the center more towards the cervix. Mesially, it's more tip towards the occlusal surface. Lingually, it is straight. So you draw the cervical line in such a way. Then remove one layer of wax towards the root. Full length of the root, you remove the wax. Then deepen all the developmental depressions. Two on the buccal side, one on the crown, one on the root, one on the mesial side, on the root. Then on the lingual root, starting from middle of the lingual root till the end of your lingual groove, you have a developmental depression which crosses the cervical line. So after you do that, redraw the cervical line, then polish all the surfaces. Almost finishes the crown. Mark the cervical line again. Luckily, the developmental depression should be visible. Or there's a weak depression. Right, so this will almost finish the tooth in all the aspects. Don't polish the occlusal surface much. Make sure all the angles of the cusps are intact. So from the buccal aspect, you will have the mesiobuccal cusp, which is obtuse. The distobuccal is 90 degrees. Mesiopalatal again will be obtuse. Distopalatal is spheroidal. See the cusp of Caraboli, redefine the fifth cusp groove. Again, from the occlusal aspect, you can appreciate the transverse ridge, oblique ridge, triangular ridge, and the two marginal ridges. So, this finishes with our carving of the tooth.